So I'm not very good at talking about my feelings, but this little bad boy recently arrived, and I've had a few questions from people, friends and family and fans and stuff, asking how does it feel like to have 1 million subscribers on YouTube? And that's really got me thinking. Like, I've been pondering this for a while. Like, how does it feel like to have 1 million subscribers on YouTube, and how has it felt over the last 3 and a bit years of churning out content week after week and slowly getting to this point? And so in this video, I'm going to generally ramble and talk about my feelings about how it's felt like along the way. We're going to be talking about kind of the motivation to keep going. I'm going to talk about haters and how to deal with that, the experience of kind of fame. And we'll talk a bit about how the feeling of the numbers changes over time and how the feeling of the revenue that the channel generates changes over time and the idea of hedonic adaptation and this sort of stuff. It's going to be fairly rambly, somewhat self-indulgent. If you're looking to be more productive, watch anything by Matt DiVello or Thomas Frank. This is not that sort of video, but it might be interesting to give you an insight into the psychology behind someone who is hopefully gonna now have 8 million subscribers, golden plaque thing. Anyway, let's get started. So honestly, I never really thought I would get here. When I started YouTube in the summer of 2017, like, the idea of hitting a large subscriber count was just not even on the cards. I remember I started with about 47 subscribers. Those were, you know, just random people who somehow subscribed to my channel because I had a Google account since 2007. But I started off with the 47 subscribers, and at the time, I knew someone who had 4,000. And I thought, damn, 4,000 seems almost unattainable, but hopefully if I can do this consistently for a year or two, I might be able to hit 4,000 subscribers. And I was looking back through my stats, and I saw that it took me 52 videos and 6 months to hit my first 1,000 subscribers. So I was making 2 videos a week for a whole 6 months, 52 total videos before I even hit 1,000 subscribers. And that was quite baffling because I'd kind of forgotten how slow the growth was. And there's this graph I came across recently, which really describes this amazingly well. So we've got the kind of exponential growth in terms of channel subscribers and views and revenue. So this is a standard graph of what compounding gains look like. At the start, it's really, really, really slow. And then over time, it just accelerates and the flywheel continues. But I think it's interesting if you overlay the graph of memory retention and like the forgetting curve on top of that, because right at the start, that is when we have the most kind of strong memory about the amount of work and effort that goes into this. But then over time, our memory of that stuff kind of decays. And so now at this point, 3.5 years later, I think this is now my like 302nd video. I've actually forgotten how much effort and work this was back in the day because, and it just feels so natural now. It's like, yeah, I make 2 or 3 videos a week and what? That's fine. Like, it just feels like such a normal thing. But certainly at the start, like, I had no idea I would be even shooting for any kind of big numbers. 4,000 subscribers was like, I think I can just about get to this point if I work really, really hard. At the time, I knew someone, my friend Ibsmo, who had about 50,000 subscribers, and I was thinking, okay, there is no way in the world, there's no way in hell I'm ever gonna get to 50,000 subscribers. That's just not even on the cards. It just was not even a possibility. And so the next milestone really was 5,000 subscribers, which I see that I hit in March of 2018 when I had 78 videos published. So it took me 52 videos to get to 1,000 subscribers, and then another 20 videos on top of that, 25 videos to get to 5,000 subscribers. And then it took me about 2 months and I was around about 95 videos to get to 10, 15,000 subscribers. And then the channel growth started to sort of accelerate. But even at that point, even when I was at 20,000 subscribers, I kind of thought, okay, 50, 60K, that's something to shoot for in 2 years' time. And there's no way in the world I'm ever gonna hit 100,000 subscribers. And my friends at the time were saying, like, obviously you're gonna hit 100,000 subscribers because your growth is accelerating. But in my head, it was like, no, this is just too big a number. There's no way this is gonna be possible. How can there possibly be 100,000 people in the world who just want to hear me talk about like studying or about productivity or about my desk setup? And this is a letter from Susan Wojcicki, the CEO of YouTube. I'm sure it's printed and not personal, but the thing about subscriber count is that I've never really cared about it. I always knew that sort of fixating on subscriber count was just a totally pointless thing. And so ever since like 5,000 subscribers, I haven't really given a thought to, oh, we're gonna hit this many subscribers, we're gonna hit this many subscribers. Obviously, it's something that I look at every day and be like, okay, how is growth going? But it's just a number that has stopped meaning anything and stopped meaning anything like absolutely ages ago. And a lot of people have asked me, you know, how do you have the motivation to keep on continuing making videos, especially when the growth is really slow at the start? Like, you know, 52 videos to get to the first 1,000 subscribers. The goal was not a numerical goal. It was not a goal of I need to get to X thousand subscribers or I need to get to this much revenue. It was instead a process goal. It was a goal of I need to make between 1 and 3 videos a week, and that is the only thing that I care about. And because that was the only thing that I cared about, you know, that was my goal, and that was something entirely within my control. It is completely within my control whether I make 1 or 2 or 3 videos a week. It's not at all within my control how many views they get, how many subscribers I get, how much revenue I get from the videos, how much people like me. All of that stuff is just outside of my control. And so I think in general, what I try to do is I really try and set goals that are input goals, like goals that are completely within my control, like how much can I do? And that's the only thing that I'll focus on. So I think that was what helped me at the start, just not fixate on the numbers. Because if you fixate on the numbers and you've put out 10 videos and no one's watching them and you've got no subscribers, you're gonna think, damn, what's the point? But if you recognize that this is not about the numbers will come as a side effect over time, the score takes care of itself, then I think that's an easier way to do it. Let's talk about hedonic adaptation as well. Let's see what Susan says. You're bigger than Vancouver, you're bigger than Venice, you're even bigger than Las Vegas. 1 million subscribers. Maybe you've imagined that day for a long time, or maybe you never thought you'd grow so big. Yep, that was me. Either way, not much can match the satisfaction of finding out that your creativity, that your ideas, that your voice speaks to 1 million people across the globe. That is where I disagree with Susan here. She says, either way, not much can match the satisfaction of finding out that your creativity, your ideas, and your voice speaks to 1 million people across the globe. And here we have to talk about hedonic adaptation. So hedonic adaptation is this idea that in psychology, it's a fairly standard thing that the more of something you have, the more acclimatized you become to the thing, and your goalposts completely shift. This is often used in psychology research when they talk about money. So kind of to use my personal example, when I was 13 years old and making £6 an hour in my day job, in my part-time job, and making like £24 a week, if I got like £20, that would be like, oh my God, best thing in the world, like £24 a week. That's like, I don't know, £96 a month. I'm so rich. But as I've gotten older and as I've started to make more and more money, the bar for what is a good amount of money to make or what is an expensive item or anything like that has just completely gone out of the window. And I was saying to my housemate just last night that, you know, I spent a few thousand pounds on like the new Apple M1 MacBook Air, MacBook Pros and stuff. And that just felt so cheap. Like I could not believe the bargain I was getting because the way that I view money is now so radically different to what it was back in the day. Back when I first started looking at laptops and thinking, oh my God, a MacBook costs £1,000. That's just so expensive. And I think this idea of hedonic adaptation, that the value of things changes internally to us over time, very much and annoyingly also applies to the views and the subscribers and the messages that I get on YouTube as well. And this is something that I really try my very hardest to fight against because I know it's just really bad, but it's just how human psychology works. Like at the start, in the first few weeks, I'm refreshing my phone every 2 minutes and being like, oh my God, I've got 66 subscribers. Yes, we've got one more subscriber today. Or, oh, today was a great day. We got 3 new subscribers. I can't believe it. Whereas now it's like, if I get a video that only gets 50,000 views in the first 24 hours, I think, oh God, what the hell is the point of that? If I have a day where I've only got an extra 1,000 subscribers rather than 2,000 subscribers, I'm thinking, come on, like this is a terrible day. What the hell is going on? And this is just so annoying because obviously I try and think to myself that these numbers are real people on the other end of the screen. And I think one of the challenges that we all have to do as we're growing up and becoming more successful or whatever is try and remember what it felt like to do the thing at the lower level. Like, you know, the joy I would feel when I made £20 at work or the joy I would feel when I had 2 extra subscribers. I try and remind myself of that joy anytime I'm feeling, oh crap, this video's a bit crap. It only got 100,000 views and 3 days and falling into that comparison trap. Incidentally, this is where I absolutely hate the YouTube Studio app. So if you're a creator on YouTube, you have this special YouTube Studio app. And the very first thing you see when you go on it is you see how well your latest video is performing relative to your previous 10 videos. And so if your video is 1 out of 10, that means out of the previous 10 videos, this is the number one. So you're feeling really happy, like, yes, I've got a 1 out of 10. My video is doing well in terms of views, in terms of watch time, in terms of whatever. But if you have a video, if I have a video that's like 8 out of 10, 9 out of 10, 10 out of 10, that means it's underperforming compared to my previous 10. And that really puts me into this like spiral of depression where I'm like, oh crap, you know, what is life? Why is this video doing so badly? Oh, people have realized I'm an imposter. People have realized I'm a fraud. No one's gonna watch my YouTube channel anymore. I'm gonna end up homeless and broken. That all happens. And then I have to like CBT myself and have this like chorus of, you know, the Stoics and stuff in my head, and people like Gary Vaynerchuk being like, it's not about the numbers, it's about it's about having fun, it's about providing value, and 50,000 is still a lot of people, and all of that. And it's just all of these shenanigans, mental shenanigans, that we as creators have to do to get over the fact that our videos are underperforming. And again, a way to help with that is just to remember that 50,000 is still yeah, actually quite a lot of people. And 3 years ago, I'd have been absolutely overjoyed if a video had got 50,000. That would have been a viral video. But now 50,000 videos feels like, ugh, this is a bit crap. Let's talk a little bit about haters now. Actually, let's see what Susan is saying. We know that being able to touch the lives of so many people is reward enough, but we're incredibly proud of all you've done, and so we hope you'll accept this gold creator award as a token of our self-esteem. Esteem, not self-esteem. Freudian slip right there, am I right? And this is the 1 million subscribers thingy. That's quite nice. Random box. I'm gonna caress this while I talk about this idea of haters. I feel like one of those like villains stroking their cat. So haters are interesting, right? Because haters are like one of the phenomena of the internet that everyone kind of knows about. Often one of the first questions I'll get when people find out that I've got a YouTube channel, other than, hey, how much money did you make? Which is, you know, it's a question that some people ask, is like, how do you deal with haters online? I think it's weird because A, everyone has this misconception that there are just loads and loads of haters online, which is absolutely not the case. Like 99.9999% of all my comments are just really nice and supportive and friendly. And very occasionally I'll get a hate comment. But it took me about like a solid year before I started getting any hate comments at all. And this is one of those stupid things that keeps, I say stupid because I used to suffer from this. It's one of those stupid things that keeps people from not putting themselves out there online, thinking that, oh, if I put myself out there online, people are gonna leave a comment saying I have a big nose, or saying that I'm too hairy, or saying that I've got sweat patches under my arms, or saying that my voice isn't nice, or whatever. But at the start, like for the first year, no one is watching your stuff, like no one cares. And the people that are watching it are gonna be the people that are like, oh my God, this is cool, this person's got 24 subscribers and they're making a useful video for me. Why on earth would they leave a hate comment? That's like just not even a thing. So I think at the start, you don't have to worry about hate comments, because the people watching your videos are the people who love you anyway, and like, oh my God, thank you, you're sharing life about a Cambridge medical student, or you're sharing about your tarot addiction or whatever. Over time, as the numbers start to swell, and as you start getting videos that go more viral, i.e. hit people outside of your subscribers, at that point you do start getting more hate comments online. Now, when it comes to hate comments, there are some that just don't affect me at all. Like if someone says, hey bro, you talk too fast, or huh, you're a virgin nerd, lol, what a loser, or like, oh, your nose is too big, or whatever, like, you know, those comments, I honestly couldn't care less. Like, they do not touch me in the slightest. I've been doing this for long enough that I actually just don't care. The sort of comments that do kind of get to me are along the lines of, your videos used to be really good and you used to be really altruistic because you really cared about helping people, but over time, as you have gotten more famous and more successful, your channel has gone downhill because now it's obvious that the only thing you care about is money and fame, and therefore I'm unsubscribing. Those are the comments that are like, ah, damn. Because there has to be a shred of truth to that. Like, over time, my psychology and my psyche around this channel has changed. The fact that I now don't try and reply to everyone on Instagram. Like, up until like 10,000, 20,000 subscribers, I was replying to absolutely every single Instagram message that I got, from people asking for advice and people saying nice things. And now I get like 50 to 100 DMs a day, and I just don't even see like 99% of them, let alone be able to reply to them. Occasionally I get emails from people being like, oh my God, you know, I've spent so much time watching your videos and I can't believe you can't even do the courtesy of replying to my email. And it's just like, you have no idea how many, like, I get 200 emails a day. It would be a full-time job to reply to everyone's emails. I'm sorry, but that's like not a thing. And so those things are things that I know have happened to me. And so in my head, I'm thinking, huh, maybe this person is right. Maybe the thing I'm chasing now is just fame and attention, money, and all this kind of stuff. I think this is tricky because people always say, and I've spoken to other creators about this, about this idea of haters, and people saying that your videos used to be good because of X and now they are bad because of Y, and it's usually as they become more successful. I think those comments feel a bit weird because, like, for me, even at the start, the reason I made videos was not altruistic. And this is like one of the weird aspects of the parasocial relationships between kind of creators and an audience on the internet, is that it pays to give the impression that what we are doing, creating content on the internet, is purely altruistic. It pays to give the impression of like, hey friends, you guys are my friends. I'm sharing this video with you purely because I, you know, it'll add value to your life and I want to help and I'm a really nice guy. And that image of I'm doing this for non-selfish reasons. But underneath, like for literally everyone, underneath that, there is the less sexy reason of I'm doing this because I know it's going to make money. I know I want attention. I know I want an audience and I want fame. Because of the selfish benefits it brings me down the line. And so for me, at the start, when I had like 20 subscribers, no one is thinking that I'm doing this for selfish reasons because I've got 20 subscribers and I'm making no money. But now that I've got 1.2 million subscribers and I'm openly open and transparent about how much money I'm making, it's now very easy for people to say, hey bro, your videos used to be good because you didn't used to care about money. Now you care about money. It's like, no, I've always cared about money. I've always cared about treating YouTube as a business. I've always been interested in teaching. And the way that I view making these videos is like, I'm teaching people online at scale, sharing my experiences, being like, this sort of stuff kind of worked for me. Maybe it'll work for you as well. So that's kind of the feeling that I get when it comes to those comments. But at the same time, there's a part of me that thinks maybe he's got a point. Maybe I have become just an arrogant, narcissistic twat who sort of expects a certain number of views on the internet and who expects people to follow him because he's famous, and he's even using the word famous because it's just all these things that happen for specifically for those comments like that. So yeah, when it comes to haters, I really don't care about comments on my appearance or, oh my god, you haven't got a girlfriend, or, oh my god, you must be a virgin, lol, thank you for the original comments there. But it does get to me when people say that your videos used to be good and now all you care about is money, you twat. Anyway, the other interesting one is anytime you ask people for money, people will complain. So I have been very scared of selling stuff because I know that there is going to be a subset of people in my audience who are going to say, oh my god, this guy is a scammer because he has the audacity to charge money for something. And recently, actually sort of a few weeks ago, I released this course called the Part-Time YouTuber Academy, which is like a four-week live intensive interactive course. It's starting next week, tomorrow, depending on when you're seeing this video, starting on the 16th of November. That's the first cohort. More info in the video description. The cohort is closed. You can't enroll for it now. The next cohort's gonna be in February 2021. But I didn't even mention this course on YouTube. I mentioned it on Twitter and Instagram and my email newsletter. But even then, on one of my recent YouTube videos, someone commented saying something like, oh my god, Ali has become a total scammer. He is releasing a course and it costs $2,000 and about how to do well on YouTube, and he's a total scammer and all he cares about is money. And I was like, god. And that comment had like 80 likes on it. And I was like, bloody hell. And in my head, I'm thinking, well, you know, no one's forcing you to buy the course. I'm not selling a result. I'm selling kind of, you know, this is like super intense. This is like, you know, 24 hours of literal me teaching you live on a Zoom call in front of a camera with homework assignments, with like guest workshops, with like three events happening each day, with like lots and lots and lots of stuff going on, and a team working full time to make this experience as great as it can be for the students. And we've got 400 people in the cohort who have been happy to pay the prices. And we have given loads of scholarships out to people who can't afford it. Like all of that stuff is in my head. And yet this dude, it's always a dude, on the internet commenting that, bro, you're a scammer because you have the audacity to charge money for something. It's kind of a bit hurtful. I can see why it would happen. It is very easy when someone has, like, you know, I spent like the last 3.5 years creating free content online. I've made courses on Skillshare, but Skillshare is effectively free. You can sign up for the free trial and then it's basically free. To some people, it can seem like, oh my god, this guy is now taking advantage of his audience by charging money for something legit. And again, that kind of hurts. You can't really get over it. And everyone I've spoken to, you know, my mate Matt Diavello recently released his own course, and he was talking as well about just how many people complain that it costs money. I was like, well, you know, this is a job. You know, I've got to pay the bills, got to make money somehow. This is a business. It's a business at the end of the day. And again, coming back to the parasocial relationships, it's this idea that people have that, oh, if someone is creating videos on YouTube, they must only purely be doing it altruistically. And anything beyond that, anything that even hints of this person has selfish motives, this is a business, this person wants to make money, that is enough to call this person a scammer. So that's kind of interesting. That's another kind of variety of hate comment that occasionally I let get to me. Let's talk about now about being proud of achievements. This is something people ask me about Instagram. Like, you must feel really proud. How proud do you feel that you've hit 1 million subscribers? And honestly, I don't feel proud at all. I don't like the feeling of pride. I don't even know what it means. Like, what does it mean to be proud? I can say, like, I'm proud of someone. And if I'm proud of someone, that kind of means I'm happy for their success. And I understand they've struggled to get there. And I feel I've had some kind of hand in their success. Like, I wouldn't say I'm proud of Ed Sheeran for getting number one in the charts, even though, like, it's a good achievement and he struggled hard to get there. I wouldn't say I'm proud because I've had no personal connection to him. But if my brother's startup did well, I'd be like, oh, I'm proud of that because I can see the amount of effort and time of it that's gone into it, and I feel a personal connection with him. But when it comes to feeling proud of myself, I just never have that feeling at all. Because I think the feeling of feeling proud of yourself is totally pointless. The way that I think of it is that I basically can't take credit for anything that I've done. I honestly cannot take credit for this thing. The official thing to say would be like, oh my god, it's all because of the fans. Thank you so much, fans, for, you know, 1 million fans. Without you, I wouldn't be here, blah, blah, blah. That would be like the official line. But the way that I actually think about this is that who I am is just a result of circumstances and luck. And I was very lucky to have a few unfair advantages that I managed to stack up on to make this YouTube channel. I was very lucky that I read the book Show Your Work by Austin Kleon in 2016 that encouraged me to start my blog. I was very lucky that at the time in 2012 when I started medical school, it was very easy to set up a business helping people get into med school. So I did that and I made some money out of it, which meant I could afford decent camera gear right from the start. I was very lucky that I got into Cambridge University, which was, you know, a big name university, and I was trading off of the brand value of being at Cambridge. I'm very lucky that I decided to go for medicine because, you know, being a doctor, again, trading off the brand value of that. I'm very lucky that my mum decided to move us to the UK to prioritize mine and my brother's education when we were really young. And without that, none of this stuff would have happened. So all of these things are things that I just really can't take any credit for. And the way that I think of it is that all I've done is I was dealt a very good hand, and I don't think I squandered the hand that I was dealt. I think I played my cards reasonably well, but that's not something to feel proud of. That's just like a, it is what it is. And so when people say, how proud do you feel that you hit a million subscribers? Which is a question I got through Instagram sometimes. I kind of feel like I just don't relate to the feeling of being proud of myself in any regard. Maybe that's bad, maybe that's good, who knows? But that's just kind of how I feel about that. Let's talk about the experience of fame. Now this one is kind of interesting because the first time I got noticed was, it was only about 3 months into my YouTube career. It was around about November of 2017. I'd been creating videos from like June or July that year. So 4 months into my journey. And I was making videos about interview preparation for medical students. And one day I was in Cambridge Town Center with my friend Catherine and we were at a restaurant. I think it was some Italian restaurant. And she was telling me off for being a bad friend because I was too focused on videos and not, and she sort of needed some help in some regards. And I hadn't picked up on that. So she was kind of telling me off for being a bad friend. And there was this girl and her parents sitting next to us who kept looking over. And at the end, she came up to us and she was like, oh my God, Ali and Catherine, I recognize you from the videos. You've given me amazing interview advice and I've got my Cambridge Medicine interview tomorrow. And I was like, damn, okay, that's cool. So that was like the first time someone recognized me in real life while Catherine was telling me off for being a bad friend because I was focusing too much on YouTube. That was interesting. Since then, I now get recognized a few times on the streets when I go out, kind of in non-lockdown times. It always feels a bit weird because I'm like, I want to be nice to this person and I want to chat to them and stuff, but I also don't want to waste their time. I recognize maybe they just want a photo. Maybe they don't even want a photo. And if I suggest, hey, do you want a photo? It's going to be weird, really weird. If they say like, hey, can I get a photo with you? They're going to feel embarrassed. I can ask them the name, what they're up to, but if they're with friends and stuff, then it's kind of awkward. And it turns into this kind of like awkward thing. And I'm sure I'm overthinking it and I'm sure they're not thinking about it in as much detail, but it just feels a bit weird to get, like weird in a good way. Like I always really like it when people come up to me and be like, hey, I love your videos, man. It's just that after that point, I don't really know where to take the conversation. The thing that I started doing, well, I've been doing for a while, for the last like 3 years now actually, is I have this standing offer, an open invite that I talk about on my website, where if anyone wants to grab a coffee with me, they can come to Cambridge and, or if they're passing through Cambridge, I'll buy them a coffee, no questions asked. So for the first 2 years of doing this, I would meet people after work at my hospital's canteen, grab them a coffee, made a few friends that way, met up with lots of people from all around the world, which was really awesome. And now recently, kind of when lockdown wasn't a thing in the UK, we have kind of Tuesday afternoons as being like my meetup day. And so every week I just kind of station myself in a coffee shop in the Cambridge Town Centre and people come to me to hang out. And it's really cool. And sort of we normally hang out for a few hours. Occasionally I even invite people back to my place for dinner in a non-weird way. But I've actually made a few friends and a singing teacher and a guitar teacher like through this. And one of the guys I met through one of these coffee meetups now is part of my team. He helps me out with the content. His name is Joe. He's cool. It's been a nice way of making the numbers side of things seem more real because now it's like I'm interacting with real people who like my stuff and that's kind of cool. So this is something I want to do more of, like the more physical in-person meetups, because I think that's like a really nice part of the fame. When it comes to the numbers and stuff, it's all about the hedonic adaptation. You kind of forget that there's a million people or 1.2 million and you look like, because that's not, again, it's not about the numbers. It's just about continuing to plug away at the videos. And even now, I don't even think about the numbers. I care about subscriber count in that I want it to be going up over time because it's a sign of channel growth. But beyond that, I just don't think about the numbers at all. A few more things. So let's talk about what it feels like at different levels of growth. And at the start, it feels really good because every time you get a new subscriber or a new view, it feels like you've really earned it. And it feels like, yes, another one. I think when I got to 5,000 subscribers, that was like the peak of the experience because at 5,000 subscribers, I was like, okay, now if I ever run out of content ideas, I can just ask on a YouTube comment, say, hey guys, what video should I make next? Or if I'm doing a Q&A, I now have 5,000 subscribers, and therefore I know I will get at least a handful of questions that I can answer a Q&A for. Every time I hit a milestone like 100K, 200K, 500K, a million, I kind of think to myself, does this feel any different to 5,000? And the answer is always no, this feels no different to 5,000. And I was talking to author Ryan Holiday the other day on one of my deep dives, hashtag name drop, hashtag flex, and he has a very good blog post where he talks about how it feels to be a number one bestseller. And in that blog post, he says that he was mowing his lawn one day when his agent emailed him or messaged him and said that he hit number one on the bestseller list. And he looked at his phone, put his phone back in his pocket and kept on mowing the lawn. And he said, it feels like nothing. And I think that's very true. Like that's very much the case for me as well. People say, how does it feel to hit a million subscribers? How does it feel to hit 100,000? It honestly just feels like nothing because the number isn't what matters. It's the work. And, you know, a philosophy that I've recently started to really apply to my life is that the only real objective is to do the work so that you can continue doing the work. It's playing like an infinite game where there is no end goal. The only goal is to be able to continue playing the game. And for me, playing the game is being able to release videos on YouTube. And so my only goal is to be able to continue doing that. And so, you know, something like this nice rose gold, not rose gold, whatever this is. It's all very nice, but it actually doesn't feel like anything. And actually this arrived in the mail about a month or 2 months ago, and I knew I wanted to film this video and unbox it throughout, but I just didn't really care about it because it's, I mean, who cares? It's not the point. The point is just making the videos, and it's doing the work so that you can continue doing the work. This YouTube thing is an infinite game. For me, it doesn't have like an end goal or an end state, or I know I've won the game once I hit 10 million subscribers or whatever. It just feels like, yeah, I just want to continue playing the game, because playing the game is fun and it's profitable and it helps people and all that kind of stuff. Finally, let's talk about the money side of things. And I think the money side of things is interesting on a sponsor front. So I remember it took me about a year and a bit. I got my first sponsorship deal in the summer of 2018 after making, how many videos did I make? Ah, I was on 52,000 subscribers and I had made 120 videos. So 120 videos after I started YouTube, 52,000 subscribers, the first sponsor reached out to me. And when a sponsor reaches out to you, it's absolutely mental. Like, you think, oh my God, I can't believe you're giving me this free money. And I think my first deal was for like £1,000. I was like, what? Someone wants to pay me £1,000 just to mention them in a video for 2 minutes? What the hell? Hell yeah, this like genuinely feels like free money. And every creator that I've spoken to has had a similar experience when it comes to sponsors. And for me at the start, and every time I'd get a new sponsorship deal, because I was negotiating them myself and signing contracts and doing emails back and forth. And you know, when a sponsor comes to you, usually it's through a middleman agency, and they say something like, hey, Squarespace would like to work with you. How much would you charge for a 60-second integration? And then you think, damn, how the hell do I know how much to charge? And you just pluck a random number out of thin air. And then they try and talk you down from it. And then you think, I'm not sure how much I'm worth. I'm not sure how much I should be getting paid. And you try and ask other people, but people are a bit cagey about it. And it's all very, it's all this kind of black box of like, how much should I be being paid for a sponsored video? Because we're solo creators, like at the start, I was making kind of £500 to £1,000 per video, which is absolutely insane. That's like a really, really high amount of money. But now I'm making a lot more than that. And I can't tell you how much I'm making because that's against the term of my sponsorship agreement. But it just feels so weird. As like, no one would bat an eyelid if Coca-Cola spent $200,000 on a TV commercial. But if Coca-Cola pays a creator $200,000 to plug their product in a video, then that feels a lot more different, even though the end result is the same. The way I used to think about sponsors was, oh my God, I can't believe this is free money. The way I now think of it is that it's just another another line item of revenue in the business. And because I work with a lovely agency, we get sponsors all the time, and sort of every week we pretty much have a sponsor lined up. So it's now become something that I don't have to think about. Just another line of revenue in the business, and I can focus on creating the content rather than on worrying about the monetization behind the scenes. Those were lots of rambly thoughts about what it feels like to hit a million subscribers. Again, if you've gotten to the end of this video, thank you so much. Please leave some kind of emoji in the comments, like a clover leaf or a tree or something, just so I can see how many people have gotten to the end of this video. This is going to be really long, but this is awesome. Thank you so much. The fans are amazing, the viewers are amazing, the audience is amazing, but these were just a few things that go on in my head about kind of the journey to get to a million subscribers, how it feels like now I'm here, and kind of moving forward. I'm gonna do another video where I talk about like 15 lessons I've learned on route to a million subscribers, so that might be interesting. But if you've gotten this far, thank you so much for watching. Normally at this point, I would sort of pitch you to an end screen that has like a playlist, so we'll put a playlist of popular videos there. But to be honest, if you watched this far, thank you very much. I really appreciate you. All the best. Leave a comment down below if you have any questions about anything. And yeah, I just wanted to say, wish you a lovely rest of day and stay safe and enjoy the pandemic and all of that sort of stuff. So thanks for watching. Bye-bye.